Welcome back to our Intro to Flow Cytometry series. In case you missed any of the previous episodes, make sure you click the link in the description so you can check them out. Today's episode will be an illuminating discussion on the optical systems of flow cytometers. Let's take a look. In our previous episode, we discussed the fluidic system, which is the system that transports your sample from your tube into the machine. Today we're going to look at where the fluidic system and optic systems intersect at the flow cell, as well as the filters downstream that are used to detect your signal. So the optical system of a flow cytometer is really just comprised of a series of lasers and filters that allow you to both activate and detect your fluorochromes. When we think about detecting the optical signatures of our cells, we can look at both the light scatter properties of our cells as well as the fluorescence emissions. Thinking about light scatter, this is where you've probably heard of forward scatter and side scatter. So these are the two major properties of cells that we look at with our light scatter. Now, forward scatter is classically referred to as the size of a particle. However, this is not always the case. It's really a measurement of the diffracted light. It's called forward scatter because the detector is at a forward angle from the light source, so directly across. The other form of light scatter we'll be detecting is called side scatter, and it's called side scatter because the detector is at a 90 degree angle from the light source. So on the side scatter detector, what we're detecting is instead of the light that diffracts around the cell, we're detecting the light that bounces off things inside the cell. So because of this, side scatter is often termed the granularity or complexity of a cell. Forward scatter and side scatter has been commonly used as a tool by immunologists because it's a very easy way to distinguish lymphocytes from monocytes from granulocytes because they all have very different patterns in terms of forward scatter and side scatter. However, even non-immunologists can use this to do things like remove debris from your samples, or get rid of really dead cells because these will have very different scatter properties than your other particles and cells will. However, to truly determine if a cell is alive versus dead, you require a viability dye. Do not rely solely on your forward scatter and side scatter to do this. So the first step in determining which fluorochromes you can use on your machine is to look at the excitation profile. These can be found on many common online resources. So if you look at this profile up in the corner, you'll see initially the fluorochrome is unexcited. It will have a low signal. This will start to raise as the fluorochrome gets excited and then peak and drop off and kind of bottom out. So when you're determining which lasers you can choose to excite this fluorochrome, you want to make sure you pick one that is in that central peak zone of excitation. So if we look again at this representative plot, which laser line would you choose to activate this fluorochrome? If you chose the 405 laser, you are indeed correct. The peak excitation will come using a 405 laser. So if you wanted to use this fluorochrome, you would need to first make sure that the instrument you were using had a 405 nanometer laser. Downstream of the lasers, you then have a series of filters that break up the light and send it onto detectors. Now these filters come in three main flavors. These would be the long pass filter, the short pass filter, and the band pass filter. Now if we look at the long pass filter and say we have a long pass 500, essentially what this means is any light longer than 500 nanometers will pass through, any light shorter will not. A short pass is the opposite. So a short pass 500, anything shorter than 500 will pass through, anything longer will not. And then finally, the bandpass filters are really key in focusing on a certain band of light. So say we have a bandpass 500/30. This means that the center of the band will be 500 nanometers and we'll have a total band size of 30 nanometers. So the range of light let in by this filter will range from 485 nanometers to 515 nanometers. It's important to note that the second number, the 30 in the 500/30, indicates the entire range of the band, not the range on either side of the center. On the screen, you'll see the unique filter setup found in DD flow cytometers. Now, while this may not be the same as the setup in your flow cytometer, the theory behind how the filters work will remain the same. So in this instance, the light passes into the filter set and first hits a 735 long pass filter. This means that any light 735 nanometers or longer will pass through this filter and be sent to a 780/60 bandpass filter. Now this bandpass filter will then allow through a range of 750 to 810 nanometers, or a 60 nanometer band centered around 780 nanometers, and this light will be sent to the downstream detector. If we go back to the 735 long pass, this filter is set up as a dichroic mirror, so any of the light that did not go through and was shorter than 735 nanometers will bounce and hit the next long pass filter, which is a 655 long pass, and the light will continue to bounce around this filter set until it finds a filter that it can pass through. So going back then to determining which fluorochromes we can use, after you determine if you have a laser to excite a fluorochrome, you then need to determine if you have a filter set that will detect the emission. So in order to do this, you would then look at the emission profile from that fluorochrome. And ideally, you would want the peak of that emission to be falling within one of the filters that you have on your instrument. As you can see in the example here, the peak emission falls within the 405/50 filter, meaning that we will both be able to excite this fluorochrome with a 405 nanometer laser and detect the emission with a 450/50 filter, meaning that this fluorochrome can be used on this machine. Downstream of the filters, you'll find the detection system of a flow cytometer. So this is usually comprised of things like photomultiplier tubes or photodiodes. We'll be looking at this more in our next episode, so make sure you hit the subscribe button and click the little bell icon so you don't miss out on anything. And with that, we'll see you in the next one.